there. Good evening. Welcome to ITV News Tyne Tees. Tonight's headlines.
The jury is sent out in the trial of Christina Robinson, the mother accused of murdering her three-year-old son.
Also tonight, the menace of potholes. A new report says the maintenance backlog could mean that most of our roads are facing major repairs in the years ahead.
Just go over them, and some of them are really, really deep, and it's just awful. Absolutely horrendous.
I'm surprised I haven't flipped your car yet, the amount on this town. You're paying that much money to be on roads. I can't afford to keep fixing the car.
Plus, the adult learners worried that funding decisions could affect their service, the WEA.
And why more of us are getting serious about DIY. First tonight, the jury has retired to consider its verdict in the trial of a mother accused of murdering her three-year-old son. Christina Robinson denies killing Dorlania.
She dismissed her legal team last Friday, choosing to represent herself. In her closing speech to the court, she insisted, "I did not kill my child."
Our correspondent Tom Barton has been in court for us today. Tom, normally this speech would have been made by Christina Robinson's barrister.
Yeah, that's right. The judge today told the jury that Christina Robinson was going to make her closing speech effectively as her own barrister. That's because, as we've heard on Friday, she dismissed her legal team and opted to represent herself for the remainder of this trial. Now, Christina Robinson is accused of losing her temper and violently shaking Dulania on the day that he died, as well as of a series of child cruelty offences. Today, she spent an hour and 8 minutes speaking to the jury about the evidence that's been presented during this case. She took issue with some of the expert witnesses, saying, yes, they are experts, they have their qualifications, their years of experience, but it does not mean that everything they say is true. Going on to argue that there is nothing that directly incriminates me, there is nothing that says she deliberately did this, nothing that says these are her handprints, nothing, she said, that ties me directly to killing anybody.
And Tom, she also addressed the fact that she lied initially about how he'd suffered some of his injuries.
Yes, that's right. She's accepted lying to police, to doctors and to paramedics about how Dulania came to be severely burned in the weeks before his death. Today she told the jury that she lied because I didn't believe that anybody would believe the truth, and added, I stand here telling you the truth. I stand here having owned up to my lies despite how it makes me look. She concluded by asking the jury, please do not find me guilty for something I've not done. Now this afternoon, at 4:06, the judge sent the jury out to consider their verdicts, telling them they needed to reach verdicts on which they are all agreed. Christina Robinson denies murder and child cruelty. The trial will continue tomorrow.
Correspondent Tom Barton, thank you. Next tonight, it's been a year since the law changed, making it illegal for anyone under 18 to get married in England and Wales.
Those who campaigned for the change hoped it would help to reduce the number of child marriages.
Recent figures from one charity, though, show a 15% increase in reports of child marriage over the past year, raising concerns that the law isn't being properly enforced. Amrit Birdie has been finding out more.
At 16, Fahana was told she was going to Bangladesh to see her grandmother. Instead, she was being taken to be married to a stranger and was told she couldn't return to England until she became pregnant. Now, decades on, she has been part of the campaign to change the law in the hope of protecting other children from the trauma she endured.
There were several opportunities where what had happened to me would have been flagged by someone else other than me, would have taken the onus off me. For example, when my passport expired, the immigration officer in Bangladesh, the High Commissioner, didn't question that I was a 16-year-old, now heavily pregnant. My return ticket had expired, my passport had expired, and I was without an adult parent. Here presenting myself at the High Commission in Dhaka, having been, you know, in the UK for all my life before that. And I categorically believe that had the law been there, that wouldn't have been a question.
In the 11 months since the minimum legal age for marriage was raised to 18, these figures, shared exclusively with ITV News, show that in the Northeast they dealt with 41 cases of forced marriage, and one of those was a child marriage. Across the country, there was a 15% increase in child marriage cases, with the average age of the child being 15 years old. It's a sharp contrast to the most recent figures published by the government's forced marriage unit from the previous year, which show a drop in cases. Charity Karma Nirvana say they think the reason they're seeing an increase is a lack of education and enforcement around the new law.
Sadly, we haven't seen, since implementation, the necessary awareness and training that, you know, when you have law that gives rise to safeguarding duties on police officers and protection and new crimes, you need to be preparing those professionals to know how best to respond, and we just haven't seen that.
Yasmin Khan works across the Northeast, helping victims of forced marriage and honour-based abuse. She says the number of forced marriages is probably even higher than what is reported.
The prosecution came in 2014. In 10 years, there have only been 4 successful prosecutions. Young people do not want to hold their parents or the perpetrators to go through the whole prosecution process. So we need to do more to ensure people can get the support that they need. Forced marriage is really underreported, so we need to make sure that we know what those risks are.
We contacted the forced marriage unit asking for their figures from the last year, but were told they weren't ready for publication. Instead, the Ministry of Justice sent us this statement. Child marriage destroys lives and denies vulnerable children the freedom to learn, grow and thrive, which is why we have increased the legal age of marriage to 18. Our dedicated forced marriage unit also provides support and advice for victims and those at risk of forced marriage, both in the UK and overseas. Those working tirelessly to put an end to forced and child marriages say despite the law change, it feels like there's still a long way to go in protecting all children from the devastating impact of child marriage. Amrit Birdie, ITV News.
Next tonight to that problem for drivers almost everywhere, going over potholes in the road. A new report claims two-thirds of local roads in the northeast could need major repairs in the next 15 years because of potholes.
Yeah, the survey by the Asphalt Industry Alliance, which specialises in road maintenance, gathered data from local authorities across England and Wales. It found the backlog of repairs and maintenance in our region has reached an all-time high. Chris Jepson reports.
They can be big. And even wet. Potholes, the bane of the lives of most drivers, and here in Darlington, it's no different.
Potholes everywhere. All up there, road up there, everywhere I go. It's a joke.
They're very expensive to fix, I guess, when you kind of don't spot them and you, well, I should know, I've had to get my brakes and stuff fixed before and stuff, so yeah, very annoying. Just go over them, and some of them are really, really deep, and oh, it's just awful, absolutely horrendous. They seem to be fixed, and then they soon have they been fixed, and they appear again. It's just extremely annoying. Yeah.
Well, if we're going to be paying for something, they should be fixed properly. At least, I don't know whether it's the quality of what they're fixing it with, if it's a cheap solution or something, but something needs to be done about it. You know, I can't afford to keep fixing my car. I've literally just had to get 2 new tyres, pop wheel.
You really don't have to look far to understand how massive a job it would be to repair all of the potholes in our region. Just on this stretch of road alone here in Darlington, I've counted around 60 potholes that are in desperate need of attention. A year ago, the Prime Minister visited Darlington to announce new spending to repair potholes and resurface roads. And although £15 million has been spent fixing around 200,000 potholes in the region over the last 12 months, a new survey suggests it would cost more than £800 million to tackle the backlog of carriageway repairs in our region.
The life that's left in two-thirds of the roads is 15 years. And yes, you'd have to either reconstruct the roads or at the very least, take off a layer and resurface the roads. Local authorities haven't been given the money they need to keep the roads in the condition that we all need as a society.
The
£8 billion of reallocated HS2 funding over the next 11 years, which it says is enough to resurface more than 5,000 miles of road across the country. But with each bump on our journeys, each crack in the road, potholes are going nowhere fast and are something we just need to keep avoiding. Chris Jepson, ITV News, Darlington.
Police searching for a missing 80-year-old woman on Teesside say they found a body. Gloria Clark was last seen leaving her home on New Year's Eve. The body of a woman was found in the River Tees near to Surtees Bridge in Stockton. No formal identification has taken place, though police say Gloria's family have been informed.
The head of Durham University has insisted we did the very best we could to support students when staff boycotted marking papers. University and college union members took the industrial action between April and September last year in a dispute over paying conditions. Durham's Vice-Chancellor told a committee of MPs today that 18% of their academic staff took part, meaning some students were delayed in getting their degrees.
During the summer, we ran a series of supplementary exam boards as marks came in. By August, we had about 13% of our students with no guaranteed degrees. So we were able to whittle that down, but 13% is still very many students. So we made the students a goodwill payment of £500. Not a compensation, they were still entitled to ask for and claim compensation, but a goodwill payment.
You're watching ITV News Tyne Tees. Still to come on tonight's programme, we find out why DIY courses are booming.
And a major event for Newcastle Eagles women's team as the big one returns this weekend.
And changeable sums up the next few days. Spells of rain, sometimes blustery, and towards the end of the week, a return to northerly winds. Temperatures are about to fall, I'll be forecast later.
Now, protest has been held over plans which it's claimed would severely reduce the number of adult education courses across a large part of our region.
This spring, control of the budget for adult learning will switch to a new North East Mayoral Combined Authority, which will stretch from County Durham to the Scottish border. It's inviting bids to run services, but one current provider, which teaches a wide range of life skills, says its clients will be hit hard by the changes, as Helen Ford reports.
Spelling out their concerns, some of the adult learners worried for the future of their education. Among them, Joanne Hassan, who's attended several programmes run by WEA, or the Workers' Educational Association. What began with training in life skills led to her current course to become a teaching assistant.
When we look around, we're not all 16-year-olds. This would be a massive barrier to me to have to go and sit in a classroom with 16 and 17-year-olds, purely because it's having the inclusion, and I wouldn't have that kind of inclusion in college.
Thank you. So respect the confidentiality of your client.
This course, which is run by WEA, teaches the roles and responsibilities of being a professional interpreter.
I have been interpreting for about 4 years now, and I actually haven't had much confidence, so I was a bit anxious of like accepting interpreting appointments. But since I've started this course, I'm more confident.
Now, though, WEA says training like this is under threat as a result of changes to the way funding is allocated. From May, a new North East Mayoral Combined Authority will be established, covering Tyneside, Wearside, Northumberland and County Durham. Among its powers, control over the adult education budget. And while it will provide grants to local colleges, it's asking other providers to bid for funding.
The new combined authority says that you, along with other organisations, are free to bid for new contracts. Surely that is fair.
That is right, but at its absolute limit, if we were successful and it is an open and competitive process, we would be able to deliver half of what we currently deliver. So we then have to make some really tough decisions about which residents in the North East lose their community education provision.
According to the new combined authority, community learning is a priority. It says it's aware there'll be an element of disruption as a result of the changes, and says it's continuing to listen to all those with an interest in what happens. It told us we have encouraged providers to come forward with a range of innovative courses to support people with health, confidence and well-being as part of their learning journey, alongside the industry-aligned courses that will help adults into work. While today's protest was in Newcastle, similar gatherings are being held in all seven councils which make up the new combined authority, in a bid to convince leaders to think again. Helen Ford, ITV News, Newcastle.
Now, if you've tried to get work done on your home recently, you may have found that tradespeople are in short supply. In fact, by the end of the decade, it's estimated there'll be a shortfall of more than 16,000 tradespeople just in the northeast.
And that means homeowners are getting frustrated. Plus, it's thought that the region could miss out on around £5 billion of economic growth.
Because of this shortage, a growing number of people are taking steps to learn DIY skills to tackle many of the tasks themselves, as Kevin Ashford reports.
Getting work done on our homes, it seems, is getting harder. Demand is increasing, while the pool of available tradespeople is getting smaller. Steve Markham's been trying to get someone to top up the insulation in the loft of his home in Walker in Newcastle, but so far, without success.
We got in contact with this chap who'd been recommended to us from our in-laws. He came along, he had a good measure up, he gave us a day rate. The only thing he couldn't do was the job right now, but he said he'd get back to us in September, October. Still waiting.
And it doesn't look like things are going to improve anytime soon. The UK is facing a shortfall of 250,000 tradespeople by 2030. Here in the northeast, the shortage is expected to be more than 16,000, costing the region £5 billion in missed economic growth. Well, given those numbers, what's the answer? One solution is discovering the power of a power tool. And a lot of people are learning to do it themselves. Demand for classes that teach DIY techniques like this one is booming, as people look to learn basic skills and save money.
If you'd like to know how to use it, take it up and you're going to hold it like this. Okay, you're going to hold it by the head.
I've lived in my flat for 18 years and there's so many little jobs that I've tried to do and can't do. And my dad was a builder and my granddad was a joiner. And it just really annoys me that I don't have those practical skills.
We've been calling out handymen for doing random things that we've needed so far. It's very expensive, so we've been thought that we'd come and learn how to do it ourselves.
I'm just going to do a little bit more DIY, being able to be independent around the house, you know, put up curtain rails, put up a picture, put up mirrors. So just not having to be dependent on somebody else.
I wish I'd just learned it at school, really. I wish we had these skills taught from a younger age, because especially if you're a homeowner. It's just invaluable, really.
Oh, more talk. You don't have to take it out,
Maggie. Oh,
okay. Leave it in.
I think that people knowing more DIY skills would lead to better communication with tradespeople, actually, because those little tiny jobs that you do around your house, they're not economically viable for tradespeople to always come and do. So I think it's sort of, I don't think it has to lead to conflict. I think it could be a positive thing that householders will be able to do their own little things.
The government says it is investing in apprenticeships to make more skilled tradespeople available. But in the meantime, one of the options for some of those jobs might be to do them yourself. Kevin Ashford, ITV News.
And the ITV Evening News continues at 6:30 with Mary Nightingale.
Coming up on the programme, the first person to be convicted of cyber flashing in England is jailed. He admitted sending explicit photos to a woman and a child, intending to cause alarm, distress or humiliation. It was back to business for Prince William today, after Kate was pictured in public for the first time since her surgery 2 months ago. And the films that children see will have less nudity and sex, as stricter guidelines are introduced for 12 and 12A ratings. Jonny for those stories and more at 6:30. There's a big weekend of women's sport ahead for the region. Newcastle United are in the National League Cup final. That's on Saturday. Sunderland face Durham in a women's championship derby on Sunday.
We'll look ahead to the football later in the week, but tonight the focus is on basketball as the Newcastle Eagles women's team take their turn in the spotlight. Salmon O'Rourke reports.
A basketball team is always a work in progress. It's a sport where details are important and peaking at the right time is crucial. But this weekend, progress takes on a wider meaning because the big one is back for 2024. It's the fourth time the club has taken a women's home fixture and expanded it out into a big event. The idea is to get more fans, especially young fans, into the Virtue Motors Arena to get a taste of women's basketball. It's led to big crowds and great occasions. This time, the opponents are the Sheffield Hatters on Saturday evening.
I think it's important not only for us as players, but the organisation and for the next generation coming through as well. Like, it's great to represent, you know, the club and the academy and everything that stands for. So, yeah, it's a game that I really look forward to every year.
An opportunity to get everybody rallied around the women's game, and the staff have been very, very diligent in trying to promote it. That's both on the ground in the community and within the academy. And we just hope to see those young faces getting excited about the women's game. That's Matt Newby, who came in as Eagles women's head coach last November. He's got a heavyweight CV, having won the National Cup when he was coach of the Worcester Wolves men's team. He's also brought in some mid-season reinforcements, like Tierra Hodges, who played in the women's All-Star game last weekend.
All-Star game was a great experience. I really enjoyed that. Just to be able to play amongst some of the best players in the league, I really enjoyed it.
How are you enjoying it here in Newcastle?
Oh, I love it. I love it. I love my team. I love that I was given this opportunity. I came late. As you know, I got here in December, so I had to kind of get acquainted really quick, but they welcomed me really well, and I think I fit right in.
So tell me about this team. How good is it?
Oh, you're great. We're great. No, of course, every team's looking to improve every game, but every day we come on here, we work hard and we try to make each other better. So when May comes, playoffs come, I think we'll be ready.
The Eagles women have won their last two games and look certain to reach the end of season playoffs. A big win in the big one against Sheffield on Saturday night would be another step in the right direction.
Yes, Simon O'Rourke reporting there, and good luck in the big one. Now, we just want to point you in the direction of a really fascinating report that's now available for you to watch on ITVX. The North East has a rich fishing heritage, and in North Shields, sculptures are popping up on the fish quay to celebrate those who were part of it.
Yes, the most recent is the Herring Girl, a tribute to the many women from all over the country who came to Tyneside during the herring season.
They were fiery, strong, and without them, the fishing industry would not have been the booming industry that it once was. Katie Cole's been finding out more.
The Herring Girls were known for having sharp knives and sharp tongues, and they proved the skeptics wrong, that the fishing world was just a man's world.
Very, very labour intensive. A lot of men were away fishing. They couldn't get the people, the workers, to process the herring. So there was a lot of argy-bargy, you know, women can't do this and women can't do that. But they came and they made an impact, and they've done a really, really good job. It's a very important job. And some of them could cut a lot faster than men anyway. They could cut like 50, 60 herring a minute. So that's like 1 second, so that's pretty quick.
What do you hope people take away when they walk past the Herring Girl?
Well, I want them to look at it, and I want them to think, well, what's she doing? And, well, herring, and as long as they take away and remember, the fish key's moving on now, for as long as they walk past it and think and take 1 second to think about what she was there for, that's the important thing for me, then the girls are remembered.
And you can find that report, along with lots of other special reports on ITVX, just search online or on your connected TV. And don't forget, ITVX is also where you can watch this programme back again every night.
Ross is here for the weather now. Ross, another mild day. That's two in a row. This is incredible.
I know. That's we had a thing. Don't say that.
Yeah.
It's going to get cold out. I don't want people to get lulled into that. We are looking for signs of spring at the moment, and there was a definite one at the allotment this afternoon. I was out with the camera and noticed a bit of toing and froing from one of the nest boxes this afternoon. It is early in the year, but there's nest building going on there. You can see it's a sparrow. I thought it was just a normal sparrow, but it's actually got a black patch on its cheek, and it means it's a tree sparrow. So I'm going to have to try really hard not to disturb them, because they are listed as a red species of conservation concern. I'm going to be very careful around that at the moment. No going in the shed.
No, don't go in the shed.
Exactly. So they're looking after the mild weather at the moment. I say temperatures have been climbing today pretty much across the board, well above the average for the time of year. We're getting used to it. It's not going to last. We return to some frost, even maybe some wintry weather as we head into the weekend. Let's take a look.
Good visibility on the horizon. TUI sponsors ITV 10T's weather.
Some lovely spells of mild sunshine for us today. The cloud, though, increasing as we make our way overnight. A sign of things to come, actually. We are going to see some patchy rain spreading in, still with us as we head into tomorrow. Still on the milder side for now, but we are starting to see that change through the next few days. More in the way of rain and also temperatures falling as we head towards the end of the week. That's tonight's rain into tomorrow, moving up from the southwest, sinking its way down towards the south through the afternoon. And then further rain will start to spill in from the west as it is towards Thursday and into Friday. That's where we get that real change in wind direction coming down from the north. Temperatures dropping back down to where they should be at the time of year. That means over the highest ground, we could see a little bit of wintriness as those showers move through. For now, though, actually, as we head through this evening, generally dry. Overnight, the cloud, though, is increasing, and we're starting to see those spells of rain arriving. It's going to be patchy as it moves its way across the region. Can't rule out the odd heavier burst into the early hours as well, but thanks to the cloud cover, the mild air that's over us at the moment, temperatures do hold up around 7 or 8 degrees. So again into tomorrow morning, it's not a chilly start of the day, but certainly unlike today, it's looking pretty grey and damp. Now the rain's still with us through the morning, into the afternoon it is starting to push away, and behind that we're starting to see some brighter breaks developing into the afternoon. Some winds coming in from the North Sea, adding a fresher feel out towards coastal areas, but inland still reaching up into those double figures. Overnight Wednesday and into Thursday, some clearer skies around, so decent start of the day first thing Thursday morning. But again, the clouds will start to thicken, some patchy rain spreading in, and for now, staying on the milder side.
TUI sponsors ITV 10T's weather.
Thank you, Ross. In just a moment, the national and international news.
And I'll be back here with a late update at 11 this evening. From all the team here, they'll have a great night. We'll see you later. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.